Do these men look happy to you? They should look happy. They've just been handed the keys to the British Columbia economy. Back in 2007, this Chinese-owned Canadian mining company includes the proposition of using imported labor from China in their application to the federal government. In March of 2011, BC Jobs Minister Pat Bell tells the media each Chinese-owned underground mine would create 300 to 400 jobs or more, plus another 5,000 to 6,000 spin-off jobs. There is no mention of using Chinese guest workers. In November 2011, BC Premier Christy Clark announces during a trade mission that a $1.4 billion investment from China in BC mine development will create over 6,700 jobs and other economic benefits under the BC Jobs Plan. Still no mention of the use of temporary foreign workers. In 2012, Prime Minister Harper changes the temporary foreign worker program, allowing companies to pay temporary foreign workers up to 15% less than prevailing Canadian wages. From 2011 to 2012, Canadian Dewa advertises jobs in Canada for their operations, but part of the job requirements include Mandarin as a second language. Wages advertised reflect Harper's 15% less strategy. Dewa then claims it cannot attract Canadian workers. In October 2012, it comes to light in the media that Dewa will initially bring in 200 miners from China to their Murray River operation near Tumbler Ridge, BC. The BC Jobs Minister Pat Bell defends the move, citing Canadians' lack of skill in coal mining as the reason Dewa cannot find local workers. Under pressure from mining unions, Minister Bell did backtrack and suggest that Chinese miners could be used to train Canadians to mine underground for coal. What Minister Bell didn't do was consult the U.S. Mine Rescue Association, which reports over 50,000 coal miner deaths in China from 2001 to 2011. Dehua's chief executive frontman, John Kavanaugh, claims they are working closely with the BC government to teach Chinese workers roughly 100 English words related to safety. No mention of translating the BC Mines Act into Mandarin or instructing Chinese workers on our standards of health and safety. In October 2012, a Taiyi investigation reveals employment agencies in China are legally charging 12,500 Canadian for the privilege of coming to work in Canadian mines. They also advertise hourly wages far below Harper's 15% less for temporary foreign workers wage scam. Then in October 2012, Prime Minister Stephen Harper introduces the Canada-China Investment Treaty. If signed into law as planned November 2, 2012, it would allow Chinese investors to sue the Canadian taxpayers if we attempt to interfere with their projects and potential profits. In October, the United Steelworkers and the BC Federation of Labor demand an investigation into the hiring practices of Chinese companies. The only question is, should the people responsible for bringing temporary foreign workers into BC be investigating the scandal? While we should not refuse to extract our resources or fail to trade with other nations, we should do so on terms that are favorable to Canadians and the rest of the world. We should stop and think before allowing foreign corporations, backed by an undemocratic state, to take control over our natural resources. And we certainly shouldn't let them break the law or give them an unfair trade advantage by importing low-paid workers. Make no mistake, Canadian workers will ultimately be forced to work for less as they compete against cheap foreign labor in their own country. Worse yet, when Canadians get upset at the inevitable economic conditions and attempt to use their democratic voice to stop the destruction of their economy caused by these policies, they will be trumped by Chinese companies exerting the corporate rights that Harper's Canada-China Investment Treaty gave them.
What they're trying to do here is criminal. It really is. And for them to even believe for 1 minute that they're helping BC, that's crazy. And Christy Clark is, as we all know, is full of crap. I mean, what they're trying to tell us that they're creating all these jobs. Well, they're not creating jobs for BC people or Canadian people.
Slavery. It's a form of slavery. Just an extension, a little bit more devious, but slavery. People are denied their rights as immigrants.
Yeah, we have a sock puppet for an MLA. Pull a string and he'll spout the party line. Guy can't manage the Rob Anders of BC provincial politics.
This is a plan by the corporations and the governments that within 10 years, our wages will be down 15% because they'll say, too bad, we'll make it non-union and it'll just be foreign workers. And it's nothing against foreign workers in any way, shape, or form, but give our people our protection.
It'll be the end of the middle class as we know it. We're already well on the way. This has to end, and it's got to end now.
So we've got workers all over the country here that are looking for jobs, miners, good miners, and know what they're doing. And the government's saying no qualified workers. It's bullshit. Complete bullshit. Workers applied for those jobs. Those 400 jobs they gave away. 400 jobs they gave away to people that are coming in almost as slaves. They gave them away, and when people applied for those jobs, there was 319 applicants for those jobs. Any one of those guys could have done that work. Not qualified. Well, you know what not qualified means? It means they're not willing to work for nothing and put their lives at risk for a company that doesn't give a shit about them. It's bullshit. Complete bullshit. It's ridiculous.
The resources are going to be shipped away. I thought they belonged to us, the citizens of Canada. I thought those were our resources. And we elect the government to look after that for us. They're not doing a very good job. Time to go. Time to get rid of them.
I think the government's got to rescind what they've done here. Look at the future of our province. And let's start hiring our own people. BC jobs for BC workers. No doubts.
We need to give these jobs to our own people, our children, the military, the unemployed. We don't need to bring in foreign workers to take our jobs.
There is people in Canada that can do these jobs. And, you know, we need to look at our people first. It's not about being discriminating against other races, by no means. We're not saying those things.
Well, safety's going to go downhill. I know the government says they're going to retrain them to BC standards, but given our government, we highly doubt it. They'll just hand it over to the companies, and companies are going to want to cut costs.
Slaves are not good for any economy. Slaves are not good in China, and slaves are not good here. Temporary foreign workers are going to destroy this economy. We're all going to be out of a job, and our children will suffer. This is a ridiculous notion that we do not have coal miners in BC or we do not have underground miners in Canada. That is a lie, it is bullshit, and our government clearly is corrupt. Bill Bennett has been served with an eviction notice. Thank you, sir. Flash your lights if you don't agree with temporary foreign workers.
Well, Colleen, it was a surprise. HD Mining found itself at the center of legal battles over its temporary foreign workers, and it appears tonight that is the reason why its mine is now on hold.
This is a ridiculous notion that we do not have coal miners in BC or we do not have underground miners in Canada.
It was a controversial decision from the outset, HD Mining hiring up to 200 Chinese workers to operate its $350 million underground longwall mine near Tumbler Ridge. This video is from the United Steelworkers website.
Canadian workers will ultimately be forced to work for less as they compete against cheap foreign labor in their own country.
The unions also took HD Mining to court over its claim that it couldn't find Canadians to do the job. The company says the lawsuit was too much. This was a difficult decision for us, but we are very concerned about the cost and disruption this litigation brought by the unions has caused to the planning of the project. So the 16 Chinese workers already in BC are being sent back. The company was building a $15 million housing project in Tumbler Ridge. Construction will continue, but the mayor is concerned.
It's disappointing that that decision's been made. Certainly, there's a lot of local people that have been working at the site, and hopefully their work is not also put in jeopardy.
Labor leaders say this is an opportunity for the company to hire Canadians.
The mine is still viable. There's still coal in the ground, and we need to work with the company to develop it properly.
Now, the company says it is still committed to the mine, and it will continue the legal battle, but in the absence of any certainty over its labor situation, that project can't continue for now.
Colleen? HD Mining, temporary foreign workers, you were wrong.
What's your name?
Alex Hansen.
Oh, hey, Alex.
How are you?
Shake my hand?
Oh, absolutely. Cheers. You were wrong about all of it.
I don't know if I was wrong.
Yeah, you are. Yeah. They weren't even longwall mining there.
You're wrong about that. I'm sorry.
As you can see, Mr. Bennett clearly doesn't have his facts straight. Remember back in October 2012 when HD Mining began importing temporary foreign workers to its Tumbler Ridge operations because Canadians supposedly lacked the skill for longwall mining? Remember when the Tai reported that temporary foreign workers paid exorbitant recruitment fees in order to get mining jobs in Canada? Remember the provincial investigation into recruitment fee allegations turned up nothing, but shifted the responsibility to the feds who have yet to reveal any findings? Just what were we to think of all the resumes released by court order through federal filings that show experienced Canadian miners had applied but were rejected? Why did HD Mining send home all of the Chinese temporary foreign workers in January of this year, even though a judge ruled their presence legal last December? And then there's always the human rights complaint against the United Steelworkers filed by one of HD Mining's temporary foreign workers that was ultimately rejected by the Canadian Human Rights Commission. But Mr. Bennett isn't the only one who seems to be politically disoriented these days. A number of former BC government employees also seem to have lost their way. John Kavanagh, former Assistant Deputy Minister, now CEO of Canadian Dewa. Jody Shimkus, former Assistant Deputy Minister, now Vice President of HD Mining. Brian Clark, former Executive Director of Resource Stewardship, now Executive Assistant Project Manager at Canadian Dewa. Judy McCullough, former Senior Advisor, Mineral Resource Development, now Vice General Manager at Canadian Dewa. And who could forget John Graham, former Mines Inspector, now General Mines Manager for Canadian Dewa International Mines Group. Just why are all these public servants bailing out of government and into private sector business financed by foreign corporations from an undemocratic state? It's just revelation after revelation until finally we find out that HD Mining wasn't even going to be starting with longwall mining at all. Documents obtained by the United Steelworkers clearly show the original mine plan was to start with room and pillar. I thought longwall mining was the reason we couldn't hire Canadians in the first place, which brings us back full circle. Shame on you, Bill. I guess you are simply wrong.
You are. They weren't even longwall mining then.
No, you're wrong about that. I'm sorry.
No, it's room and pillar. We just got the files. We got it. You're wrong.
This is Jody Shimkus presenting awards when she was an assistant deputy minister with the Ministry of Natural Resource Operations, a ministry that includes mining. Shimkus left provincial government in January to go work for HD Mining. The government places restrictions on senior managers who leave public service. For a year after they leave their jobs, they're not supposed to lobby or make any representations for any outside entity to the ministry where they last worked.
I think she's conflicted.
Now union leaders are questioning whether HD Mining's Vice President Jody Shimkus violated the policy.
She's really lost track of who she worked for.
After several requests for an interview with Jody Shimkus, we went to the downtown office to see if we could speak with her in person.
I was not told of any restrictions. I'm not aware of any restrictions being applied to me.
But the public service agency told CTV the policy applies to her until the end of 2012. I asked her if she's dealing with the ministry where she worked last year.
HD Mining has permits and authorizations that require dealing with all government ministers.
Mm-hmm. And you represent the company on those?
I work on permitting and regulatory matters, yes.
Permitting for an underground coal mine project near Tumbler Ridge, a project that is under fire because HD Mining obtained permits to bring in temporary foreign workers from China. The federal government's investigating whether those permits were obtained properly. Union leaders want the provincial government to also investigate whether Jody Shimkus is following the rules for senior managers who leave. They're also filing a complaint. Late today, we heard back from the public service agency, which says there doesn't appear to be conflict, but they will look into it further. Mi Jiang Li, CTV News, Vancouver.
You bring a guest worker into Canada, they surrender their passport, they're indentured to the employer, they can't quit their job and go somewhere else, they can't look for a job somewhere else, they can't generally complain about their job. They can't complain about health and safety, because if they do, they're given their passport and a plane ticket back to where they came from.
If those workers are good enough to come here and work in Canada, they should be able to come here and live in Canada. They shouldn't be exploited by labor brokers in China and have to pay fees for them to find jobs for them, and then be exploited by employers here who charge them exorbitant room and board rates and the rest, who aren't aware of their rights, who risk their health and safety because they don't speak our language and understand our regulations. We don't think that Canada was built that way. Canada was built by saying, if you're good enough, please come here. You want to come here and live here, you can work here. But to use this temporary foreign worker program is almost like lowly paid slavery.
And if anything happens to them that becomes difficult for the employer, they can just be deported and sent home. They have no rights in Canada. They can't become citizens. And not only that, they can be paid less, at least 15% less than the going rate. And as we continue to do that, the going rate drops. So you just keep dropping it by 15%, keep dropping it by 15%. We're driving ourselves to the bottom. And while we're driving ourselves to the bottom with the temporary foreign worker program, we are exploiting workers from other countries.
So when you think about that, working people should be extremely upset and mad that their government would go off and sign deals without informing the people of British Columbia that they're signing off on committing to provide jobs for temporary foreign workers. I'm angry as a former workers' representative, the idea that our government's gone off to China or any other country and signed these sweetheart deals without coming back to BC and introducing legislation and saying this is what we want to do and allow the people to debate. At least the official opposition should have the opportunity to debate it, and through that the people of BC know what's going on. But we've got a government where there's no transparency, no democracy. It's being undermined.
They say they couldn't get workers here. Well, no kidding. Who's going to work for $10, $15 less for a company that has the safety records? Like every day in China, people are killed working in the mines. And it's like the Chinese people are expendable. Chinese workers are expendable to these companies. And these are the companies that Harper and even Christy Clark, the premier here in BC, they're making deals with these companies.
There's only one reason they're doing it. They're trying to lower wages. They're trying to break unions. I think that this is definitely an attack on working people in BC. They say they can't get coal miners in Canada. I say bullshit.
Maybe she should have went up to McKenzie when the unemployment rate was 85%. It's ridiculous. We need to stand up. There needs to be a plan. We all can work together on this one. Let's make it now.
An iconic Canadian company is being accused of exploiting foreign workers brought to British Columbia. The franchise owner of a Tim Hortons in Fernie is the subject of an employment standards complaint by a former employee who came from the Philippines. As Bal Brach reports, it's the latest in a string of complaints about the temporary foreign workers program that some allege shows a pattern of mistreatment.
Does it feel like he owns Fernie?
Heidi Kibanoff left her job at Tim Hortons in June, but says she's still haunted by the painful memories.
It feels like even if we're not working there anymore, he can still try to threaten us through other people that he knows.
Kibanoff and her boyfriend Richard Pepito say the owner of this Tim Hortons in Fernie, Pierre Pelletier, hired them and other Filipinos through the Temporary Foreign Worker Program. Pepito filed a complaint with the Employment Standards Branch, accusing Pelletier of taking back part of his overtime pay.
This not paying overtime and issuing check and then keep the money back to him.
Kibanoff says Pelletier would drive her and other employees to the bank. When they cashed their checks, he would then ask for a portion of it back. She says she listened to her boss because she was in the process of the provincial nominee program, a fast track to permanent residency in Canada.
All was I thinking was I don't want to go home. And he said it's to protect us and he's doing us a favor.
We reached Pierre Pelletier by phone. Both he and his wife claim this is the first time they've heard of these allegations. However, documents obtained by CBC News reveal an internal investigation is already underway at Tim Hortons' head office.
In a statement, Tim Hortons says, "This matter has been brought to our attention. We are treating it seriously and are currently conducting a review in full cooperation with BC Employment Standards." Pelletier is also accused of charging employees the processing fees for renewing their temporary work permit. According to regulations, the employer is responsible for paying those fees.
I guess our concern through the labor movement is that employers are getting far too much power.
Kibanoff and Pepito say they've been harassed and intimidated, asked to withdraw the complaint through friends who still work at the Tim Hortons franchise.
He needs to be stopped. You know That's what? It. It's not even the money anymore. We don't care about that. But I think that is more than a strong case than what we're emotionally dealing right now. Like, it makes us feel unhealthy, stressed, exhausted, depressed.
The BC Employment Standards investigation is ongoing. A hearing date has been set for February. Bal Brach, CBC News, Fernie.
Hello.
Alex, it's Mabel Elmore.
Mabel, how are you?
I'm
I'm all right. How are you?
Pretty busy.
Yeah, so it's good the story went national.
Sure. We're just on our way down there with a bunch of steel workers to show the colors in the store. We're going to sit down and have coffee. CBC is going to meet us.
Okay, I guess good.
The owner has circled the wagons and is now threatening all of the employees about whether or not, you know, be quiet, don't talk to the media, yep. Otherwise you're being sent home. So yep. We got half the workers on our side, and then we've got workers that are in the store right now that are on our side that are pretending not to be. It's this bizarre conspiracy. So we're going to go down there and show some support. We're going to go in there. This is not for intimidation purposes. We're not here to intimidate anyone. Our goal is to go in there with our jackets on. We're going to go order some coffee. We're going to sit down next to the window. We're going to undo our shirts here and fly some colors there just to show support to these other workers. Half of the workers are ready to step forward. The other half are very scared that they're basically going to be sent home. So what we want them to see is that they've got some support in the community and stuff like that, so they're not scared. Eventually they will step forward. Hopefully that's what the plan is. So that's what we're here to do today. We're not here to get in an argument with anybody and stuff like that. So let's get in there. Let's have a coffee. Let's show our colors. And then
first, though, there are now calls for a police investigation into the conduct of a Tim Hortons franchise owner from Fernie. As we told you exclusively last night, the owner is being accused of stealing money from some employees, temporary workers from the Philippines.
Now, the province's Employment Standards Branch is investigating at least one complaint already. Val Bratch has the latest.
We just want the threatening and bullying to stop.
Heidi Kibanoff and her boyfriend Richard Pepito say they've been bullied, harassed, and intimidated by Pierre Peltier, their former boss at Tim Hortons in Fernie. They say they've been pressured by former co-workers to drop the complaint with the Employment Standards Branch. Kibanoff says Peltier would drive her and other employees to the bank to cash overtime checks. Once cashed, they say Peltier would take the money from them. Kibanoff says she listened to her boss because he was offering her permanent employment through the Provincial Nominee Program, a fast track to permanent residency in Canada. CBC News has interviewed nearly half a dozen employees with a similar story at the Tim Hortons in Fernie. We're protecting their identity because they're afraid they'll lose their jobs and be sent back to the Philippines.
They're coming to Canada under our program. And if employers are abusing them, the least we can do is say, you can stay, you can work here, we obviously need you. You're good enough to work here, you should be good enough to live here, then you should be allowed to stay.
The BC Federation of Labor is now calling on the RCMP to step in.
So we'll be approaching the RCMP and saying, please go in and investigate this, and if you find wage theft, order the company to pay or charge them.
Peltier hasn't returned our calls for an interview. The mayor of Fernie says he's well known in the community.
Whenever there's any events and he's asked, they are the first ones to deliver food to all of the events. So the community knows them as very generous, giving people.
A hearing for the Employment Standards Branch investigation is set for February. The workers are also preparing to file a complaint with the Human Rights Tribunal. Val Bratch, CBC News, Vancouver.
Policy to cover it up. Tim Hortons policy. Sweep it under the rug.
Now what that office is.
That person in the see like that, isn't that?
Yeah.
Home or on one part.
Tim bits. You didn't even get any for the rest of us.
The man at the center of a controversy involving a Tim Hortons franchise in Fernie is now speaking out. Pierre Peltier is the subject of an employment standards complaint over his treatment of some temporary foreign workers. Peltier failed to return repeated calls from the CBC or respond to our interview requests. But now, as Bal Brach reports, he has sent a letter to the local newspaper in Fernie.
And nobody ever threatened me that way. Especially, I'm not on my own country. Of course, I will feel afraid that I will be sent home.
Jenny Orenzi is a temporary foreign worker at the Tim Hortons in Fernie. For nearly 2 years, she says she endured harassment, intimidation, and bullying at the hands of her boss, franchise owner, Pierre Peltier.
All of the stress that I felt in the store, I never felt, for my 30 years, I never felt this before.
Orenzi and three other current employees say Peltier charged them for renewing work permits and took their overtime pay.
Change it to cash and give it to him.
Natividad says Peltier also threatened to send him back to the Philippines if he complained.
Like, we are nothing. You're just a worker here.
This week, Peltier wrote a letter to the Fernie Free Press saying, not only have we provided jobs for these team members, but have also given assistance by providing vehicles, bikes, furniture, laptops, groceries, and clothing to help get them started. MLA Mabel Elmore is planning on speaking at a rally on Sunday in support of the workers. Elmore says changes need to be made to the temporary foreign worker program.
Work permits should not be tied only to employers, but it should be industry specific. So that if there's problems, then workers have the opportunity to find another job.
Pierre Peltier has not returned our calls for a comment. As for Orenzi and the other employees we interviewed, they're now giving statements to the RCMP. Orenzi is even considering leaving Canada altogether if she can.
I don't want to go home. It's better to stay home.
Val Brach, CBC News, Vancouver.
The moratorium is pending the outcome of our overall policy review, which has been underway for some time. I don't expect that to take too long. I'm not going to put a precise date on it. But I hope that this is taken as a wake-up call by employers, not just in that sector, but in others, that we simply will not tolerate abuse of this program. And so we're looking at all aspects of the program to make sure that it does not have the effect of displacing Canadians, that it doesn't have it's not suppressing Canadian wage rates. And frankly, I've been blunt with employers. We want to create significant tension in the system that compels them to raise wages, salaries, improve working conditions, and increase investments in training. So what's the message to business owners and investors? To hear what we say, we mean. And to demonstrate to Canadians that they are willing to invest more in terms of wages and their employees in training. If I was vice president of of human resources for a Canadian company right now, I would be spending more time thinking about how I can recruit Canadians, include perhaps in parts of the country with high unemployment, amongst immigrants to Canada, amongst youth who are unemployed, amongst Aboriginals. I'd be thinking more about how high we have to go in wages and how much more we have to invest in training than thinking about bringing in people from abroad. And I've been clear about that for years, actually.
We begin with two major developments in our ongoing investigation into temporary foreign workers. Tonight, the government has announced an immediate moratorium on the entire food services sector's access to the Temporary Foreign Workers Program. The move comes after our Go Public unit exposed how Canadians were losing shifts to foreign workers at three McDonald's franchises, and after McDonald's put a freeze of its own on the program, which prompted the other development we have tonight. And our Kathy Tomlinson has those details for us. Kathy.
Peter, before McDonald's Canada told the public it would stop bringing in foreign workers temporarily, it held a conference call to tell franchisees. A source gave us a copy of that recording where the CEO admits rules were broken and says McDonald's has to clean up its image fast.
So we see this as extremely profitable. It's something.
He's the top boss of McDonald's Canada, CEO John Betts, clearly angry and sarcastic on the phone over the fallout from worker complaints that McDonald's favors foreigners over Canadians.
And the fact of the matter is,
We're a big, bad company, corporate, you know, bad company, and these poor, maligned employees, you know, are who they are. Yes, they are disenfranchised. Some of them don't work for us anymore, but you know what? In the scheme of things, it doesn't matter. Here's the kicker. The kicker is there's an element of truth in each one of these stories.
He tells franchisees the corporation was backed into a corner by the public outcry and the government investigation.
This has been an attack on our brand. This has been an attack on our system. This is an attack on our people. It's bullshit, okay? I used those words when I described my conversation with the minister last week. He gets it.
McDonald's volunteered to put its recruitment of foreign workers on hold briefly, he says, to preempt the government from shutting it down completely.
And in dealing with the government, the smartest move for us was to preempt their move in terms of suspending us.
He also admits rules were being broken.
What we've got to do is fix what we have in the restaurants concerning the TFWs. What we've also learned is that we have other opportunities in the people area that we also need to take care of, and, you know, it's violations of labor law. And those are the kind of things that suddenly become compounded because we have another issue over here that's very emotional in Canada.
Franchisees on the call were focused on one thing, though. When could they get foreign workers coming in again? Betts told them Employment Minister Jason Kenney's on side to help McDonald's get back to business with the program as quickly as possible.
I think the relationship we built with the minister here, I think, is a politically astute one for us to be taking because, you know, they're feeling the heat big time before this story even, you know, broke. And now it's bigger and bigger. And they need to see us as partners in this, as a brand that can help them make some progress in this and at the same time give us an opportunity to clean ourselves up.
Perhaps as important as what was said on that call is what wasn't. No mention by the CEO of McDonald's making it a priority to hire Canadians, which is what the government says is the most important rule for companies to abide by. Peter?
Kathy, why do employers favor temporary foreign workers when they sometimes pay them more than Canadian workers?
Well, in McDonald's case, insiders tell me it's a way to solve all of their staffing headaches. They get a stable, reliable workforce for at least 2 years or longer if they become residents.
All right, Kathy, thank you. Kathy Tomlinson in Vancouver. The temporary foreign workers program is being sharply criticized by the C.D. Howe Institute. In a new report, it says the program has actually created higher unemployment in Western Canada. It says changes made between 2002 and 2013 made it easier for employers to hire temporary foreign workers. The report argues the program should only give employers access to foreign workers as a short-term fix until domestic workers can be found, not as a way to avoid searching for and hiring Canadian workers.
This is a big one for us, and it is critical because of our brand image and because of your need to make profits.
Mr. Speaker, the government seemed surprised last week by reported abuses of the temporary foreign workers program in the restaurant sector. Suddenly there's a moratorium, but we know there are problems as well in banking and mining and other industries too. Over a year ago, on the motion by the member for Cape Breton Canso, Liberals warned about this. To save the program, we asked for a full review to get rid of the abuses. The government voted no, and the trouble got worse. The department cannot investigate itself. Isn't it time for the Auditor General to get on this file?
The Honourable Minister of Employment.
Well, of course, Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General is free to investigate whatever he deems appropriate without direction from the government. In terms of the program, of course, if and when there are abuses, we act clearly and quickly. If we see any distortion in the labor market, we are going to address those. The program has been under review. We made many very substantial changes last year, which resulted in about a 30% reduction in the number of applications for labor market opinions. We are about to come out with another phase of further reforms to ensure, Mr. Speaker, that Canadians always and everywhere get the first crack at available jobs, and that that program is only used as a limited and last resort by employers.
Well, you know, Jason Kenney's been in charge of the temporary foreign worker program for the last 6 years. What was astonishing today is to hear Jason Kenney stand up and say there's all sorts of problems with the management of the temporary foreign worker program, but he's been the guy managing it for the past 6 years. So what the Prime Minister said in early January in British Columbia is the same thing that we've been saying in the House for several years, but every time we said that, Jason Kenney stood up and defended the program. So we're going to continue to put pressure on the government so that they'll change this program. We have a motion before the House tomorrow that would do that, and that would also call in the Auditor General to run the numbers on this program. And I think that that's the main element that's missing.
Hi, Val.
How are you doing?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Good. So I just wanted to first get your reaction to the news that Tim Hortons has taken away those franchises from Pierre. How do you feel about that?
Policy over temporary foreign workers just keeps on growing. CBC News has learned that Tim Hortons has taken over operation of a pair of franchises in BC, including one in Fernie. It stems from allegations of serious mistreatment of foreign workers, first uncovered by CBC News. Reporter Belle Bratch broke the story, and now she has more on the latest developments.
Feels like even if we're not working there anymore, he can still try to threaten us.
This was Heidi Kibanoff 4 months ago. She and her boyfriend, Richard Pepito, used to work at the Fernie Tim Hortons. Six temporary foreign workers accused their former boss, Pierre Pelletier, of stiffing them on overtime pay and threatening to send them back to the Philippines if they complained. After the CBC's investigation in December, Tim Hortons launched its own probe into the franchisee. 4 months later, the company confirms it's terminated its relationship with Pelletier because it says he failed to comply with employment standards. An employment standards branch hearing is scheduled for next week. Tim Hortons has now taken over the two franchise locations Pelletier owned. The RCMP is also investigating.
We're glad that he has no power anymore to abuse his Filipino workers.
Pepito says he feels vindicated.
We're moving on, and hopefully these things will be, you know, everything will get justice for all of us and for all the mistreatment that we had.
In a statement to CBC, Tim Hortons says its priority is to hire Canadians first. The company says it will not tolerate any abuse of temporary foreign workers. The franchise now plans to expand its internal audit of the program.
If we catch any employers misleading us in their application forms for this program, that could constitute criminal fraud under the Immigration Act.
Are you going to come to that?
But some say that's not good enough. They say the entire temporary foreign worker program is flawed.
They come over here to work, and the employer essentially has complete control over their lives. They take their passports.
When reached by phone, Pierre Pelletier said he had no comment on the allegations. Pepito, meanwhile, says he'll attend next week's hearing to explain how he was treated. Bal Bratch, CBC News, Vancouver.
Things around. You can take that mic off whenever you want.
Now, Troy, what did you really want to say?
Hey, what did I really want to say?
What did you really want to say?
We slayed the dragon, man. I guess what I really want to say is that it's kind of bittersweet. It's sad that somebody's got to lose their business over this, but it is what it is.
Them's the breaks.
Those, you know, you do the crime, you got to pay the time, or whatever that crazy saying is.
For the Honorable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, Conservatives have approved the use of temporary foreign workers at hotels, restaurants, gas stations, convenience stores, nurseries, truck stops, casinos, and ski lifts, all at minimum wage. If a company can hire temporary foreign workers at minimum wage for any job they want, why would they ever pay a Canadian more than minimum wage? This is a massive interference in the free market. Isn't that, in fact, what the temporary foreign worker program is all about? Keeping wages artificially low.
to see that the leader of the opposition has been converted to free market theory, Mr. Speaker. Congratulations. Who knows? He might actually change his position and start supporting tax cuts instead of tax increases. Yeah. Mr. Speaker, you know, 99% of the temporary foreign workers who were paid a minimum wage were in the seasonal agriculture worker program, which the NDP wants to keep, and the live-in caregiver program, for which we have since raised the prevailing wage rate. The other 1%, the prevailing wage rate, the median was actually at the minimum level in each province, but the vast majority are well above that, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Tell that to the 1.3 million Canadians looking for a job.
Now the government is moving to close the loopholes to ensure foreign workers are only filling vacancies that can't be filled by Canadians. Here are some of the big changes. There will be a 10% cap on low-wage temporary foreign workers that employers can hire by 2016. There'll be an increase in the application fee for employers. That's going to be $1,000 per position. That's up from $275. There'll be fines of up to $100,000 for employers who abuse the program, and employers will be barred from hiring low-wage temporary foreign workers in areas where unemployment is higher than 6%. Okay, so there will be more inspections too. One in four, about 25% of employers will get inspections every year. Will these changes be enough to fix the flaws in the program? Will they mean more jobs for unemployed Canadians or big headaches for small businesses? Joining me now, the Minister of Employment and Multiculturalism, Jason Kenney. Good to see you.
Good to be here.
Okay, so you've tried to fix some of the problems with many, many changes, mm-hmm. and we've highlighted some of them before talking to you. But by trying to fix some of these problems, do you have any concerns that you are also having a negative impact on some businesses who legitimately need access to the Temporary Foreign Worker Program? I'm thinking of little companies that, you know, won't be able to afford the permits now, or, you know, mm-hmm. the smaller companies, medium-sized companies, who are going to have trouble now getting access to the program.
There's no doubt that there will be adjustment costs, but quite frankly, that's the objective. It's to put more attention into this program. It's to make it, frankly, more difficult for employers to resort to hiring foreign workers. We want to, frankly, compel them to redouble their efforts to hire Canadians. And that should include higher wages to attract Canadians mm-hmm. into that particular job. Maybe it would encourage mobility from regions of high yeah. employment to those of low unemployment. Focusing on underrepresented groups in the labor force like Aboriginals, new immigrants, mm-hmm. youth. Investing more in training. And there's a lot of creative things that employers can do. But the bottom line is they should only see the Temporary Foreign Worker Program as a last, limited, and short-term resort, not as a business model.
So where did it go off the rails? Because it's fair to say the program exploded. I mean, some of it started under a Liberal government, but the numbers certainly got crazy out of hand under your government.
You know, let me correct that or address that, because in fact most of the growth you've seen in the program are in areas that have that most people don't that we no longer call temporary foreign workers. We're talking about reciprocal youth mobility programs, okay. working holidays for like Aussies that work at yeah. the ski lift for a couple of months in Whistler, or French researchers or American professionals coming up on short-term contracts. That's where almost all of the growth
right,
has been.
But you wouldn't be dialing the program back if there wasn't a recognition fair that enough, it had fair exploded, enough, right?
Fair, well, yeah. no, I wouldn't say it's exploded, to be clear. The number of temporary foreign workers requested by employers mm-hmm. has gone from about 68,000 in 2006 to about 120,000. Yes, that did double, but it only went up from about 0.5% of workforce mm-hmm. to about 0.5% of workforce. So this has not been an increase by orders of magnitude. Having said that, there are some businesses in some sectors in areas like Alberta yeah. that have become too dependent on the program, who have built a business model around it. We see in the food services sector in Alberta, yeah. which is the single most intensive use of the program, that it apparently has suppressed wages and probably diminished labor mobility. Those are the more discrete problems we're trying to fix with these reforms.
So do you think, though, that employers are really going to go out there and try and attract Canadians into these jobs? If one of the ways they're going to have to do that, admittedly, is by increasing wages, are they going to be able to afford to do that?
It's a market question. If you're living in a boom town where people are making a lot of money in oil and gas or yep. in a mining town, and there's a labor shortage of people in the low-skilled areas, guess what? You're going to have to pay them more. People will have to pay more for their coffee, for their burger. You know, there are parts of like North Dakota, Montana, that are just as hot in terms of their labor markets as parts of Alberta. They don't have a low-skilled temporary foreign worker program. Western Australia, and we never had a low-skilled TFW program in Canada outside of agriculture until 2002. Somehow, boom towns, tight labor markets managed to function without access to overseas labor at the low-skilled level prior to 2002.
You've increased the approvals, I guess, from $275 to $1,000. That's what it's going to take to get the permit now if you want a temporary foreign worker. Is there any way to make sure that that cost won't be passed on to the temporary foreign worker, that the business won't say, okay, I'm going to give you $1,000, and then once this person gets here, I'm going to take it out of their wages?
That would be illegal. Yeah. And the employer has to pay that fee for each person they apply for to bring in from abroad. No guarantee that they'll be approved, by the way. Mm-hmm. So there's a risk that the application will be refused if the employer does not very clearly demonstrate to us that they've tried aggressively to hire Canadians at the prevailing wage rate, but no qualified Canadians have applied. If they were then to having brought someone in from abroad, ask them to reimburse the cost, that would be a violation of all of the rules. That temporary foreign worker could report the employer. Sanctions would be taken. A quarter of employers using the program will now be audited. Mm-hmm. Those who commit fraud will be referred for criminal investigation. Much, much stronger oversight to prevent exactly that kind of nonsense.
Okay, so that brings me to my question about enforcement, because you've done a lot of things that will mean there are fewer people out there, fewer temporary foreign workers. It's not going to be used as much. But how do you enforce things? You're not really increasing inspectors very much. Maybe 20 more inspectors.
No, we're going from, originally the model was 3% of employers being audited.
Yeah.
That's going to go up to 25% because we're expecting fewer employers involved in the program. Much stronger powers. They'll be able to go back 6 years into the records of the employer. But all of the first thing is, we want to prevent abuse from happening in the first place. Right. And the much tighter rules are going to do that. Asking more questions, drilling down, better labor market information, more surveys by StatsCan. Mm-hmm. So we know what the local unemployment rate, what the real local wage rates are. All of these things combined, this is a very substantial package.
Yeah.
All of these things combined will constrain access to the program, and ensure that there's stronger oversight and
so
tougher penalties.
You're counting on having to do less enforcement to begin with.
Yeah, there'll be we anticipate there'll be fewer approved temporary foreign workers coming in the first place.
So you're a minister from Alberta. This is the province where it is the most used, right? What are people going to say to you when you go back and try and sell this?
Well, the employers, I know, because I've spoken to hundreds of them, they'll say that the rules are already too tough. What are you doing? My response to them will be that we see clear evidence that overuse of the general low-skilled stream in some sectors of the Alberta economy have resulted in distortions in the labor market, suppressing what would normally be an increase in wages to respond to scarcity. Mm-hmm. They need to respond to scarcity of labor in those sectors through much higher wage increases, through more aggressive recruitment efforts that will increase labor mobility to those parts of Canada. But what I'll hear from the general public, from my average constituencies, good for you. It's about time you did this. My niece, my nephew, my son, my daughter applied for a fast food job. They didn't get a call back in an operation fully staffed by temporary foreign workers. You got to stop that nonsense. That's what I've been hearing from people on the street, although it's a different view from a few thousand business owners.
Are you confident that Canadians are going to want to do some of these jobs? Because that's the other thing that businesses say, right? No Canadians want to do these
jobs.
We can't find Canadians who want to serve coffee.
Restaurants Canada points out, of their 1.1 million workers in the restaurant industry, 98% are Canadians. In the meat packing plants, which supposedly is unpleasant work that Canadians don't want to do, the biggest one in Canada, in Brooks, Alberta, 94% of the workers are Canadian citizens or permanent residents. If the pay wage is good enough, that will attract more Canadians. And there are these pockets of Canadians, newer immigrants, youth, Aboriginals, with very high levels of unemployment. And employers have got to make a very deliberate effort to recruit from within those populations of Canadians.
At some point, when you were going through this, did it seem overwhelming? It seemed like there was probably going to be no way to control this because it had become something else. I mean, you said it yourself in the press conference. Some people were basing businesses around this idea.
The intent of the program was always to be a last and limited resort, and in some cases, probably a couple of thousand businesses have organized a business model around it. We have 1,100 employers in Canada for whom over half of their workforce are TFW. So that is totally unacceptable. And they will no longer be able to do that
under
these reforms.
But those businesses might shut down now. If you're going to put a cap on them over a few years.
They will have to adjust. It probably means in some of those cases they will have to cut hours for sure. but it also probably means that they'll raise wage rates. I was just in a couple of European cities with tight labor markets where they are paying people $25 an hour for food counter jobs at fast food restaurants. And yet they're paying half of that in Alberta, supposedly in a super tight labor market. You know, I'm a free market guy, and I believe that there should be a market response to a shortage of a commodity like labor. And the market response is the price mechanism. Pay people more. Mm. More people will enter the workforce. And by the way, we're also trying to complement this through a smarter immigration policy that invites newcomers to settle where the jobs are and to have, for employers, especially in skilled jobs, to be more active in inviting people as permanent resident immigrants to come to Canada.
Minister Kenney, always good to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Reaction to the tightened restrictions has been swift and not altogether positive. Critics say the new rules are too broad and too harsh. Kathy Tomlinson has that story.
This group speaks for those whose lives are most affected. Temporary foreign workers who come here on a fast track for jobs in restaurants and retail. Fewer of them will get in now. They applaud the government for curbing abuses, but say foreign workers should have a better way in.
They should come in as a landed status with a pathway to citizenship.
Everything else is right.
The businesses most affected, restaurants. More hoops to jump through and hefty fees will likely mean many will just not bother with the program. Some say that leaves them with big staffing headaches.
Some guys have applied here 6 or 7 times and they're just not qualified to work here. But we've become so desperate that we will give some of these people an opportunity, and every single time they've let us down.
Expect to see fewer fast food restaurants and more expensive coffee.
Consumers are going to have higher prices, and the reality there is there's only so much they're willing to pay for a coffee and a burger, so it could mean reduced sales. It certainly is going to mean reduced service.
Alberta's biggest labor group says for the most part it believes the changes will curb abuse.
The minister went a lot further than we expected, and certainly much further than we could have ever hoped for.
Industry says the government's punishing the entire retail and restaurant sector for the abuses of a few.
We think that there's going to be a huge number of businesses that are going to have to scale back.
Kelly predicts Canadians won't get more jobs, they will lose them, as businesses that can't find enough good people close.
One big question is, what will happen to the thousands of low-skill foreign workers already here who want to stay? The restaurant manager you heard from says she already knows of others who have them working under the table. A big problem in the U.S., of course. So the supply and the demand still exists, which has many calling on the government to just allow this type of worker to immigrate.
Hi, my name is Alex Hansen. I'm a steelworker activist and the creator of the compilation film on the temporary foreign worker program that you've just seen. I wanted to add this little addendum onto the back because I wanted the viewers to know that the debate, quite simply, is not over. It might be relatively easy to get sucked in by a smooth-talking Minister Kenney when he says that he solved the problem, but I can assure you that the problem still exists, and in fact, none of the underlying concerns that we've raised within the labor movement have been addressed. Changing the wallpaper, raising the fees, threatening fines, reducing the number over a few years of the amount of temporary workers allowed in our society is not the solution, doesn't really solve anything. I agree, there might be some use for a limited temporary worker program, perhaps in seasonal agriculture, and there's other specialized professions that we see a need for this type of thing. But having said that, I don't think that any employee should be tied to the employer, and that's one of the things that the minister didn't address with any of this whatsoever. We have, you know, 60,000 temporary workers in our country working that are essentially tied to their employer. And that, quite simply, by definition, is indentured servitude. That, to me, is just one step in a two-step process back into slavery. That's not something that we want to have in our society. And it also raises another important point here with the temporary worker program, is the notion that we would have employer-led immigration. Since when do we have small business owners and large corporations like McDonald's or Tim Hortons or any other corporate behemoth out there as smart or as rich as they might be, since when do we have them decide who gets to come and go into this great democracy of ours? That's a ridiculous notion. We shouldn't be continuing on with any of that. Minister Kenney didn't address any of these problems. And of course, the problems associated with this program are not going to go away. The news coverage might, but it's up to us, the regular citizens, the labor activists, to talk to our friends, talk to our family, talk to our neighbors, show them the film. The film is free, pass it around, and get the debate going again and keep it alive. The last thing we want is indentured servitude in our society. Our children's future depends on it. Our own future depends on the success of us eliminating the concept of indentured servitude in our society. So the future is up to you.